Palestinian Christian and Muslim relations in the West Bank and Gaza. We are very pleased to have with us two Palestinians, Aziz Abu Sarah, who is co-executive director for the Center for World Religions, Diplomacy, and Conflict Resolution at George Mason University, who is a Palestinian Muslim in the United States, and Philip Farah, who is a founding member of the Washington Interfaith Alliance for Middle East Peace, who is a Palestinian Christian. And we're going to start with Philip Farah, who has a PowerPoint that we're going to be looking at. And then,
hello, everybody. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank CMEP for having us. I lived in Palestine for 27 years. I was born and raised there, and I came to this country in 78. Every day of my life, I'm an activist on the issue, but that trip was mind-blowing. I learned so much about what's happening. It's incredible. Okay, so back to my presentation. The basic statistics. The Palestinians are now about 2% to 3% of the population of the West Bank, less than 0.5% of the population of the Gaza Strip, 2 to 3% of the population. And of course, in the 500s, 600s, the Christians were a majority of the population until the Muslims conquered Bilad al-Sham, the area of Greater Syria. So the conquest happened around 640. And that's when Umar al-Khattab, the second caliph of Islam, came into Jerusalem. The Muslim conquest was actually welcomed by the local population. And Khalifa Umar ibn al-Khattab, the caliph, struck an agreement with the local population who welcomed him. And the agreement really paved the way for very open relations between Muslims and Christians. The rights of the Christians were absolutely protected. They had to pay jizya as non-Muslims who did not participate in military conquests, who did not get conscripted in the army, in the Muslim armies. In return for that, they paid a jizya, an extra tax, additional to what the Muslims paid, but their rights were really protected. In fact, for the first time in 500 years of oppressive Roman rule, the Jews were allowed to come back into Palestine and live and worship alongside with the Muslims and the Christians, and relations were generally quite good. Now, the absolutely worst period in the history of Christian-Muslim relations was not when the Arabs were in charge. It was when the Crusaders came. And I'm quoting from archivists, from the chroniclers of the Crusaders. According to Gesta Francorum, speaking of the Temple Mount area, our men, quote, were killing and slaying even to the Temple of Solomon, where the slaughter was so great that our men waded in blood up to their ankles. About the same account from Raymond of Aguilera, and Fulcher of Chartres said, in this temple, 10,000 were killed. Indeed, if you had been there, you would have seen our feet colored to our ankles with the blood of the slain. But what more shall I relate? None of them were left alive. Neither women nor children were spared. Of course, the Muslims and the Jews were slaughtered. But not only the Muslims and the Jews, also Palestinian Christians, you know, because the Crusaders really couldn't tell them apart. And even if they told them apart, they couldn't care less. They looked and smelled and felt like locals, and they were massacred as well. So absolutely the worst relations were really under you know, the crusader, when foreigners came and occupied. And this, of course, continued for a long time. Jews were not allowed at all in Jerusalem for many centuries. And in fact, so then the Muslims were in power, and the Christians and the Jews generally, not all the time, it was not a relationship that was free of problems whatsoever, but they flourished up until between the Muslim conquest in 640 and the Crusaders in 1044, 1099, I think, between that period, the under Muslim rule, the Christian and Jewish communities flourished. Actually, according to Abba Iban, one of the essentially the founding fathers of Israel, he wrote in his history of the Jewish people that again, for the first time, the Jewish community in Palestine thrived and again reclaimed its status as the leading community of Jewry around the world, and that so under Islam, it again regained its status as the leading cultural and religious and theological and social center of Judaism. And then the Crusaders came and destroyed it again. And again, Jerusalem was forbidden for the Jews. Christians remained under, local Christians were not treated very well under the Crusaders. And Muslims, of course, were treated very, very badly. But the Jews were not allowed in Jerusalem at all until Salah ad-Din conquered the Jerusalem again, until the Crusaders were defeated. And again, one of the first things that Salah ad-Din did, Muslim, great Muslim Kurdish leader actually, he restored the rights of Jews to live in Jerusalem. And again, you know, it was not a situation free of problems at all, but it was far, far better. And generally, the two communities, the minority communities, the Christians and the Jews, flourished under Muslim rule. So again, you know, I'm skipping over centuries now. Under Ottoman rule, pretty much the same story. In fact, my family comes from Gaza. And now people can't imagine that there was a thriving, not only a Christian community, not only a thriving Christian community, but also a thriving Jewish community in Gaza for a long time under Jewish rule. And there were grains merchants, like the Christians actually. My ancestors in Gaza were grains merchants, and many of the Jews were also grains merchants. They exported very high quality barley for upgrading the beers in Liverpool. And they flourished and they had very good relations with each other under Muslim rule. Again, it wasn't always honeymoon, but it was generally. And then the trauma of 1948. The trauma of 1948 affected Muslims and Christians absolutely alike. The Jewish forces did not check your ID. There were no IDs that said that whether you were Muslim or Christian. They did not care whether you worshipped in a church or a mosque. There were whole villages, as you know, as probably many of you know, 550 villages were totally destroyed. Palestinian communities, urban communities in Lod, Ramle. Actually, one of my Ikrat and Bir'am are cases in point, Christian villages that were destroyed and their population expelled. The account of that story by Ilyas Shakur, Father Ilyas Shakur, a Catholic clergyman, probably some of you are, horrendous account of what happened to the people of Ikrat and Bir'am. And you know, there was a law, by the way, in 1950 or 1951, I'm not sure, the Supreme Court ruled that the Christians of Ikrit and Bir'am ought to go back to their homes. The Israeli army did not abide by that decision. In fact, the gift to the people of one of the two, I'm not sure who, maybe somebody in the audience knows, the gift was Israeli Air Force came and bombed the village and its church on Christmas Eve as the villagers were watching from a nearby hill where they were basically an unrecognized village. That's maybe another thing that some of you are familiar with. Many of the Palestinians who became internal refugees in Israel had to live elsewhere, and Israel until today does not recognize some of their communities as legal communities. And that's Christians and Muslims alike. How many of you are familiar with the Kairos Palestine document? Okay, I'm preaching to the audience, to the choir. So I'm gonna quote extensively from that. Maybe I'll skip some of it, but really it says it all, basically. It says, Jerusalem is the heart of our reality. Sorry? It is at the same time symbol of peace and sign of conflict. While the separation wall divides Palestinian neighborhoods, Jerusalem continues to be emptied of its Palestinian citizens, Christians and Muslims alike. Their identity cards are confiscated, which means the loss of their right to reside in Jerusalem. Their homes are demolished, expropriated. Jerusalem, city of reconciliation, has become a city of discrimination and exclusion, a source of struggle rather than peace. And really, this is what's happening. I mean, you really, again, if you visit Jerusalem again, try to look at the geography. The geography is such that the Palestinian neighborhoods, Christians again and Muslims alike, are surrounded by settlements. And Palestinians are building in the most unlikely places. Like, I don't know if you've seen the side of the Mount of Olives that's to the east. I never imagined that anybody could live on these steep hills. It kind of looks like the favelas maybe in Rio de Janeiro. Very, very difficult terrain, and Palestinians are forced because they can build in only 13% of the area of Jerusalem because, you know, some areas are reserved openly just for Jews only. Other areas are considered green areas, and there are all kinds of restrictions. So only 13% of East Jerusalem is open for construction for Palestinians. So they build illegally, by the way, of course, and you know that, many of you, and their homes get demolished. And they build in horrible places, and they're just squeezed in. And of course, you know, if they live elsewhere for any, because it's more convenient to work at Bir Zeit, if you work at Bir Zeit or some other place, there are very few opportunities for Palestinians in Jerusalem. So they work elsewhere, and if they Israelis know about that, they take away their identity cards because they again want a Jerusalem that is rid of Palestinians. And the contrast with what happened under the Muslim regime is stark. What happened, like I told you a little bit earlier, under Umar al-Khattab, who brought the Jews back in, actually, and under Salah ad-Din, who also brought the Jews back in, is just amazing. I'm going to skip over this. How much time do I have?
You have another 5 minutes
at least. Okay. So, again, you know, Palestinian Christians have played an incredibly important role in all assets, in all facets of Palestinian life. You probably know of great Palestinian leaders like Constantin Zreiq, who is essentially considered the intellectual force behind modern Arab nationalism, George Habash and Naif Hawatmeh, two Christians who were leaders of major Palestinian liberation organizations, the second and the third after Fatah in size. Emil Habibi, who was the leader of the Communist Party, the Palestinian, and later the Israeli Communist Party. And by the way, that party, you know, which struggled against the worst aspects of Zionism, also had Jews in it, like Meir Vilner, and many other leaders. Saliba Khamis, many of the leaders of the resistance to the ethnic cleansing of Palestine were Palestinian Christians, and actually some Jews as well, in addition to Muslims. Hanan Ashrawi, you're probably familiar with her. She is the face of modern Palestinian, the younger generation, the younger leadership. She's getting old like me too, but we were very good friends back home. Afif Safi, Edward Said, but not only politics, also culture. Some of these same people, actually, like Emil Habibi, is considered one of the greatest modern literary figures in Palestine. Tawfiq Zayed, many of the prominent poets, novelists, artists are Palestinian Christians. Same in Gaza, actually. My family actually comes from Gaza. And the Tarazis, and the Farahs, and the Sayers, and the Hashwis, these are prominent families that play a huge role in the education, in the health, in all aspects of life in Gaza, and still do, even though they're a tiny, tiny minority. Their schools are some of the best schools in Gaza. In fact, many of the leadership of Hamas send their kids to Christian schools. And the majority, of course, of the students in these Christian schools, Christian-run and financed schools, are Muslims. The Palestinian Christians are a small minority. There were attacks on Palestinian Christians, like there's chauvinism anywhere in the world. There's chauvinism in Palestine. We are normal human beings. There were attacks on Palestinian Christians, but they were swiftly condemned by Hamas and by jihad, and you know, the people who are demonized in the Western media. Again, you know, that doesn't mean that I support the agenda of Hamas and jihad, but on that score, their record has actually been extremely good. Thanks. Okay, and you know, again, the institutional situation, is there still a problem with the mic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Not yet, I'm getting warm up.
Well, I'm gonna continue, I don't wanna rob into his, can everybody hear me? Yes, all right, okay, cool. So again, talking about the institutional setting in Palestine, under the Palestinian Authority, which frankly doesn't have very much authority, but the Palestinian Legislative Council, even though the Palestinian Christians are definitely less than 4%, they have six seats out of 88 seats in the Legislative Council, far higher percentage than their percentage in the population. There are major cities which have reserved mayoral positions for Palestinian Christians. Beit Lahim, let me see, Ramallah has a Christian woman as the mayor. And by the way, interestingly, she came to power in Ramallah because she aligned herself with Hamas. She was in the opposition against Fatah, and they had a very good relationship with Hamas, and Hamas actually supported her ticket. Bir Zeit is headed by a Christian mayor. Bethlehem, Zababde, a major village north of Ramallah, Nazareth, of course. Jifna, another village. Taibe, some of you know Taibe Bir. This is the second time I mention Bir in my presentation. But Taibe is another village that has a Christian mayor, etc. You get the idea. So so definitely, you know, if anything, the Palestinian majority has been extremely differential to the Palestinian Christians. And frankly, it reflects the huge role that the Palestinian Christian leadership plays in Palestine, which is quite, you know, more than their small representation in the population. And again, you know, I mentioned the points about Hamas because, you know, it's a very convenient whipping boy in the Western media. And Kairos makes a very pointed, the Palestinian Kairos document makes a very pointed, they emphasize the importance of avoiding Islamophobia, and they really give examples of how, you know, the demonization of Muslims is counterproductive. I'll wrap up now, and
thank you very much.
Okay. Okay. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in Jerusalem. I was born in Jerusalem. Actually, not exactly Jerusalem, but we like, you know, just like in the States, how we say you live in D.C. even though you live in Virginia. Anybody from D.C.? Yeah, we don't live in D.C., but we still say it's D.C. So I grew up in Bethany, which is right next to Jerusalem. It's only 3 miles away. I grew up to a very religious family. My parents are very conservative, very religious Muslims. One of my cousins is one of the main imams at the Aqsa Mosque. My parents put me into the most religious school they could find, which didn't work really as good as they expected. But my first school was actually the Aqsa Mosque itself. That's where I went to school. We'd go to Jerusalem, go into the mosque, and I spent a few years going to school there, which helped me get the religious education that my parents wanted. But growing up, I never really thought of this whole Christian-Muslim problem, because one of my good friends was Christian, and we would joke around about how he's a Christian, a Muslim, but we didn't understand really how much we are different, but we joke about the different denomination stuff. I was trying to understand the difference between Sunni and Shia, and he was trying to understand the difference between Catholics and Orthodox, and so I would call him a Sunni Catholic, and he would call me an Orthodox Shia if we want to make fun of me, and it was different than the way things get proposed here. And often, I think the main problem that we have is ignorance. A year ago, April last year, there was a pastor and professor from Liberty College. Anybody knows? Yeah. That's Jerry Farwell School. And he went to Jerusalem, and there was a bombing when he was there in Jerusalem that was carried by Palestinians. And he wrote this inflammatory, crazy article. And normally I dismiss those things as, okay, he's just being reactionary, it's not a big deal, whatever. But it was very interesting to see how ignorance is visible in that article. So he started with talking about how, as he was driving through Galilee, and he looked around and saw all these Arab villages there, and he thought, look at how nice Israel is. It allows Palestinian settlers to come and take land and build in Israel. I thought, this is pretty brilliant, because two things. One, many of those villages he's talking about are Christian villages, which he took no time to go and meet, talking about a Christian leader taking Christian community there. But secondly, these people who lived there for hundreds, sometimes thousands of years, yet he assumed they were settlers who just recently popped up and came from nowhere. You know, the whole idea Palestinians didn't exist until just a few years ago. We came from nowhere. But he went on and on explaining about how Israel gives rights to the Arabs and how Israel has a right to exist and how Israel, all of that. And at no point he talked about the rights of Palestinians, whether it's a Christians or Muslims. And rights are symmetrical. If you want to talk about one people right, you have to talk about the other. And as even we talk in Hebrew, the Christians' right and Muslims' right, we talk about everybody's right, not one group over the other. We all equal, instead of one being over the other person. I'm a terrible note taker. But he reminded me, I talk normally from my brains, but occasionally I forget. He reminded me of a few scriptures that actually come to my mind, both from the Quran and from the Bible. But the Bible talk about people being zealous for God, yet their zeal is not based on knowledge. And this is a lot of the problems we have with especially people here. But at the same time, that does not represent These people do not represent Christians and Muslims in the overwhelming majority, because Christians and Muslims both, in the Bible, in the Quran, there are tons of scriptures that talk about why we should get along, why we do get along, why we should treat each other well. But also, this is reality. If you compare, for example, if I come now, actually, there is a poll that was done by Zugby International a few years ago. And they asked Americans, why do you think Christians leave Palestine? What happens? Why are they leaving the country and going to the States? Why are they immigrating? 45.9%, they said it's because Muslims are oppressing them. Okay, we did the same question, but this time in Palestine. Let's ask Christians who do move and immigrate, why the heck are you leaving? What do you think? What the numbers were? Any guess? Only 7% blamed Muslims, and 78% blamed the occupation. That's an amazing thing about how ignorance works, how the perception here is so different than in the States. And there are many reasons. I mean, you probably get some of the emails I get occasionally, right? There are all kinds of those, but my favorite is this one I got about 9/11, which talks about the eagle in the Quran. There's this verse about, and the eagle will show up, and then they will come and attack you, and then you will go and strike them down. I thought, and it says, this is from the Quran, and it's a verse, that it's Surah 9, verse 11. So, knowing Arabic, I read the Quran a few times. For some reason, this just does not come to memory. So I opened the Quran, and it had nothing about 9/11, nothing about any eagle, because the eagle is America, you know, nothing about eagles. And the only thing it had is have compassion on people. That was the actual scripture. Yet, you get those things, and if you don't know Arabic, and if you don't take the time to verify, it is no wonder that a lot of people really think that Christians and Muslims in Palestine don't get along, because, we see all these stories, and it's obvious that something is wrong. But instead, there are so many good stories going on that hardly ever get reported over here. Last year, on Palm Sunday, Christians were not allowed, many Christians, thousands, were not allowed to go to Jerusalem. So the Muslim neighbors in Bethlehem, their Muslim neighbors said, let's go and demonstrate together at the checkpoint so we can show that we are in solidarity and tell the occupation that this is affecting Muslims and Christians and there is no difference between you and us. We're going to go and stand at that checkpoint together and say it is your right to go to pray in the church. So they get to there, they demonstrate, they get beaten up. There were the highest level, actually, also officials from the Central Committee of Fatah, Hamas, different groups. They go demonstrate, get beaten up, get arrested, all of that. The news talks about how Muslims oppress Christians. How the heck did Associated Press come up with a story of how Christians are being oppressed by Muslims when they're demonstrating together? I really like to understand, because I write for a few newspapers, and I just can't see how you can spin it. I try to spin things here and there occasionally, but I'm joking. But I'm a very honest, good writer. And if you don't read where I write, check 972mag.com. It's a good magazine. But how do you spin those stories? So there's an interest almost in viewing that Palestinian Muslims are always oppressing Christians. And many of the points Philip here shared prove exactly the opposite. Looking at how many mayors are in Palestine that are Christians, looking at the friendships, looking at, even when you get, by the way, emails, and I get those, even Warren forwarded me a couple recently about stories with names of so-and-so was evicted from his house and the Muslims came and take it. Take a moment and wait and see if it's really true or not, by sending it to somebody in Bethlehem, in Zbeide, in Ramallah, in one of those places, because I get them and I have friends in all of these places, and I normally send and say, is this a real story? And most of the times, it's a completely made-up story. But occupation affects both Palestinians and Christians the same. When you get shot at, it doesn't differentiate if you're a Christian or Muslim. I was in demonstrations together with Christians, and for some reason, the tear gas affected both of us the same. It makes both of us teary and choky, and it's no good feeling, by the way. When you get imprisoned, it's exactly the same. When my brother was in prison, he was with the Christian prisoners. There was no different treatment if you're a Christian than if you are a Muslim. A friend of mine, George Saada, who belongs to the same organization I'm part of in the Bereaved Families Forum, his daughter was killed, being shot at with him. They were driving, and nobody asked them before they started shooting, hey, wait a second, I know you're Palestinian, but can you verify if you're Christian or Muslim, because we wouldn't shoot you if you were. It's nonsense. Occupation does not differentiate between the two sides, Muslims and Christians the same. But in a later effort, I think there's a lot of connecting now. If you read Michael Oren's latest article in the Wall Street, I think, and he talks about how through the whole Middle East, Christians are being persecuted, except in Israel. They are having blast, a lot of fun. And this idea of connecting all the Arab countries to each other, assuming we all the Muslims in all the Arab countries, we have this conspiracy, we get along and we all come together and let's oppress those Christians, is ridiculous. Because Egypt is different than Saudi, and Saudi is different than Palestine. And yes, there are oppression in some of those countries. In Nigeria, there's a lot of oppression of Christians, and I think it's important to talk about that. But trying to take what Muslims doing in one country and put it on another, that's not logical. It doesn't just... A lot of those arguments are so... I'm going to be careful how I say it. So dumb. I guess I'm not careful how I'm saying it. It really doesn't make much sense. In Egypt, for example, I run also a tour company, so no, don't go with Farah's group. You come with me. Both are great, as long as you go. But we did a trip to Egypt recently. And you know, you hear so much about how Egypt is horrible and how Christians are terribly persecuted, and there are some persecutions. There is some persecution. But we get there, and it was an evangelical church that we took there. And so we want to see this whole persecution. We went and met some Christians who said, yeah, we feel persecuted. But then we went to the biggest evangelical church in Cairo. It's called Kasra Dubaba. It has about 7,000 people, members in it. It's right at Tahrir Square. And we meet with a pastor there, and we start talking to him. And he, if you saw the pictures of the Christians surrounding the Muslims as they were praying in the Tahrir Square last year, that was that church, an evangelical church inside Tahrir Square, saying, we told our members, you're either out demonstrating or you're in the church praying. And that's a different perspective. You go there's a good organization called Arab West Report, which in Egypt, what it does whenever there's these bad news about Muslims oppress Christians, they go and investigate it and find out that most of the times it has nothing to do with the Christian Muslims. So recently when the Pope Shenouda died, there was a big story about this one imam who spoke about how evil Shenouda was and how he's going to hell and all Christians are. And so they investigated it and found, yes, this person exists. However, if you compare how many positive statements existed, all the Muslims who went to the funeral, all the Muslims who were there, and actually they had a picture of this Muslim woman who was lowering water with her head covered to the people going to the funeral so she can give them water to drink. That story is not in the newspaper. It's not on the front page anywhere. But the story, if one crazy mullah, just because he had a degree to be an imam, therefore he speaks for all Muslims, is on the newspaper. So I don't want to brush away and say there is no problems at all. There are problems. Sometimes there are problems that has to do with, yes, I'm Muslim and you're Christian and we don't get along. We have groups among us, both sides, that like to convert the other, and those create tensions. There are groups among each of us that have ideologies that differ, and we don't like each other. There are Christian churches in Bethlehem that are very messianic and pro-Israel. Yeah, many Muslim Palestinians and Christian Palestinians even don't like them. So there is tension, but often that tension is exaggerated. We have to look for the good model instead of looking for the one thing that's going bad and say, here it is, you see, it's bad. If there's more good, then let's focus on that and build it up and make that as the example while dealing with the issues. And let's not every problem that happens between a Muslim and a Christian make it about religion. You know, if you get in a fight over a car accident in Palestine and you happen to be a Christian, he's Muslim, it's somehow going to be reported as Christian and a Muslim got in a fight. It was an intentional that Christian man hit the Muslim guy's car. Sometimes it's not about religion. Sometimes it's only because we're really stubborn people and do dumb things. And it can happen between two Christians. It can happen between two Muslims. Not every issue. Cross-marriage issues. You know, we know about it. Muslims get upset and Christians get upset when the woman, especially from each side, marries a guy from the other side. But you know the same thing exists within our own religions? If an Orthodox in Bethlehem marries a Catholic, sometimes there's an issue. If a Shia marries a Sunni, sometimes there's an issue. So let's not make it only Christian Muslim. Let's try, if I want to leave you with something, is there is a lot of ignorance, there's a lot of problem, there's a lot of exaggeration, but this is not too bad because ignorance can be met with education. And if we all speak out and if we all go and tell our friends about our trips, you've all been there, and how you spend time with Muslims and with the Christians and how things are not exactly what they seem here, we can help change. I've spoken to tons of groups, especially to churches around the states, evangelical churches, right-wing, whatever you want to think about. And I found a lot of openness to people to listen. It's ignorance, and ignorance is easily met with education. If we put our minds together, if we speak up, if we speak to the people who need to hear us, then we can make a difference, and we can bring back the notion that Muslims and Christians, they fought together and struggled together 100 years ago. One of the first demonstrations against the British was run by Muslim and Christian women. They walked together through the old city, walked into the Holy Sepulchre, and the Muslim woman spoke at the church. Then they crossed the road and went to Omar's mosque, which is just outside the church, and the Christian lady took the minbar, the place where the imam speak, and she spoke to the group. That happened 100 years ago. It can happen now, it's still happening now. Let's make those the stories that we model after. Thank you.
We have a half an hour for questions and responses. Okay, let's get responses. Whichever one of you wants to go first.
Okay. Regarding activism, there are definitely problems. Problems of fear. I see Christian Palestinians participating more openly for several reasons. One of them is fear. Muslims have been targeted. Muslims have been thrown in prison for absolutely no reason. It's much easier for me as a Palestinian Christian to be accepted by many audiences than it is for Palestinian Muslims. It's very sad. The 9/11 had a huge impact, and so it's a combination of one, fear, and two, the fact that Palestinian Christians seem to be more readily welcomed to the fora that are open to us. By the way, there are very few fora that are open to us. The media is practically shut out. In Europe, according to Noam Chomsky, made this point very well. In Europe, if you have progressive causes, it's going to be at a labor union. There are many fora that are open for progressive causes. In the U.S., it's very hard. Labor unions, it's very hard for us to make inroads into them. Really, the only two fora that are still open for us are the universities. I'm too old to be talking to students. There are many people who are doing a great job doing that. And the churches are open to us. But also, fear and the prejudices, unfortunately, that still reign. Charities, absolutely. Charity is part of the five pillars of Islam. And many organizations have been targeted, have been harassed to no end,
and after paying hundreds of millions of, well, I don't know, I'm maybe exaggerating, really, literally millions of dollars in legal fees to fend off harassment, basically, many of the charges against these Muslim charities are dropped. Maybe Jean Zaro, a Palestinian Quaker woman who's a feminist and a great activist. During the siege of 2002 in Ramallah, she was separated from her older mother, who was people couldn't get around because of the curfews and everything. And the people who took care of her mother were the very, very conservative Muslim neighbors who were pro-Hamas. Again, you know, I do not support the Hamas agenda, not by a long shot, but even the more radical Islamists in Palestine, that does not mean that they are anti-Christian or that the relationships have soured to the degree that is portrayed in the media. There was another question?
Land sales,
I've never heard of that at all. Now, waqf, the Muslim waqf lands, what's the translation of waqf? That's really land that is reserved for religious purposes. I don't think you can sell that even to Muslims. You can't even sell it to Muslims. Maybe there are some cases where there are disputes about whether some land was waqf or not. I have no idea. I've never, ever heard of anybody refusing, a Palestinian refusing to sell land to another Palestinian on the grounds of religious differences.
And the
you need this as well.
I'll just hold this. Okay. I agree with you exactly, and especially you need me to stand, right? And the activism thing. I find the same problem in the States. I mean, I go around and I do all kind of projects, especially focused on education in Palestine. It's very hard to get Palestinians or Arabs, Muslims here to help finance any of those, because there's a lot of fear that, what if I give it to you? Because the law is even worse. They can give it to me and know I'm not involved in anything. I work in George Mason University. It's an American foundation. But if the money from George Mason ends up going to somebody suspected, they're still in charge. They still can be put in prison for it. So it is scary, and I understand why. But I think our work in general is risky. It's also risky to stand in protest and being shot at, and that's what we have to convince everyone here is trying to be a peace activist is not a fun job. It's not a safe job. You're going to be interrogated. You're going to be sometimes thrown into jail. And there is a price to being an activist, I guess. That's what I'm trying to say. Selling land, Christians and Muslims, it does happen, but it's not as big of a deal as I think it might come across. There are situations, but places like Beit Zahur, I like the majority of it to stay Christian. I like it's a Christian character. So not many Muslims actually even try to buy there. So I'm fine with that. I don't have actually much problem with that. There are situations where people want to keep the ownership within a family. Palestine is still very tribal also. So if you go to Hebron and you go to Abu Sinai neighborhood, and somebody from the Jabari family, it's another tribe, we don't get along. I belong to the Abu Sinai tribe. They come and want to buy a house there, 70% chance they're not going to get easily the house there. So there is still tribalism that it's an issue we have to work on, because tribalism has positive aspects and has some negative aspects as well. Becoming the woman being more covered, yes, my family is, most of them are covered, and we have these arguments about it all the time. But I think what Philip said is true, because just my mother is very, very, very religious, and she's one of the most liberal, progressive people I know. She would say exactly what Farah said. I do not subscribe to Hamas ideology. So just because somebody is covered doesn't necessarily, I think more people are becoming religious, and it's normal in communities where people are poor, people are oppressed, often people end up being more religious. I'll just tell you one quick story. When I mentioned Egypt earlier in this trip we did, and we were hosted while we were there, again, this evangelical Christian group in Egypt, we call a Salafi guy, and you know the Salafis are the most religious to the right of anybody else. And we call this Salafi guy and we say, hey, would we like to meet you? And he says, meet me? No, I don't like that. What if you come to my house? We'll cook for you. We're going to host you for the day. I'm going to bring a lot of Salafis to meet with you. And we're going to have a discussion. And so we go to his house, him and his wife. His wife is with complete burqa, speaks fluent English. They spend the whole day with this Christian group, talking, having this conversation, agreeing, disagreeing, and getting along in an amazing way. And that's just because he's Salafi with a big beard, which even for me, I can have my own stereotypes at times. I'm like, how safe is that going to be? And we go into this guy's house. But it was one of the best experiences the group had, even though he was very, very religious politically. We did not necessarily agree on everything. It was actually fascinating. He started with saying, look, I'm Salafi, I'm Muslim. Me and you, Christians, have been oppressed by the same regime in Egypt. We went through the same thing. Maybe not exactly the same, but it was interesting how he put himself with the Christians in the same same place.
All right, hope everybody's had a chance to think of some more questions, because we have room time at least for three more.
My name is Anne, and you alluded to the untruth of...
So a question about the distorted reporting in the West. Why does it happen, and is there something we all can do about it? Another question.
When I have conversations about this, where it really stops theologically?
Christian Zionism.
Christian Zionism, yeah.
So yes. Christian Zionism. One more question. Yes.
Ryan.
Yes.
Okay, so nonviolent movements, Christianism.
I'll go first. Okay. You'll get tired hearing me, blah, blah, blah. But regarding the reporting and journalism, I think one good thing about the social media is we don't anymore have to subscribe only to the mainstream media. And so that's good news. So you don't have to only listen to what Associated Press or Fox News, which is a great channel, by the way, if you haven't watched it, have to say. You can watch something else. But when Associated Press came up with that article, I wrote them back and other people wrote them back. And I think if more people take the 5 minutes to say, I'm going to write back and say, this is wrong, this is inaccurate, then it will make a difference. And because they'll see that readers are not ignorant or not stupid and they will hold them accountable. Write to other journalists and say, can you report on the same issue because this is wrong reporting. Some like me at least, like to do that. So whenever I see something wrong, I'd like to write another op-ed saying why it was wrong, and it's fun to refute it. So that's a couple of the things you can do. You can comment on the article also. A lot of people read the comments, and I know a lot of them are crazy comments, but it's not bad to make a small comment saying here's where this is wrong. So that's with it. With the Zionism Christianity, that would be its own panel, I guess. It's a lot what can be said. But I can refer you, if you Google Glenn Stassen and letter to challenge Christian Zionism. He's a professor in California in Fuller Seminary, and we took him on a trip with his seminary, 60 evangelical students, to Jerusalem. And after the trip, they wrote a letter to the International Christian Embassy in Jerusalem, challenging that notion with biblical scriptures, trying to figure out ways. I mean, I like to go into more, you can go into the theology of Jews who are supposed to come here and then move and come here. I like to go more in the humanistic aspect and saying, look, the Bible says there's more focus in the Bible on helping the oppressed. Isaiah 58 about fasting says it's not to fast to just starve yourself. It's about losing the chains of the oppressed and using those and say, what is more important to God? Or you can go to Habakkuk 2 and talk about woe to him who builds a city by crime and establishes a town by bloodshed. And say, by supporting certain aspects of Christian Zionism, which spends so much money on settlements and military and so on, That is supporting building towns by bloodshed. That is not what the Bible is about. So even if you believe the Jews should be there, or according to scriptures, you can't support the bloodshed. I use also David's story. You know, David is after God's own heart, and he was supposed to build, or wanted to build, the temple. And even though he was after God's own heart, when he wanted to build the temple, remember what God told him? You can't. And the reason, the one reason he can't, is because he had too much bloodshed in his hand. Even though he was fighting with the orders from God, and still God thought, you can't build the temple because you had too much bloodshed.
I think what I said earlier, the best way to fight ignorance is through education. Learning more, coming to see, is absolutely a great idea, but also there's a lot of ways to learn. There are tons of books about Christian Zionism. I'll be happy to help if you want references. Learning as much as possible, and then going out and speaking. Something, since I'm speaking to mainly, am I speaking to mainly Christian group, assuming churches from Middle East, peace? So one thing always interesting about the Bible, when I read stories of apostles and prophets, when God speaks to them into a message, he never says, here's what's right, here's what should be done, why didn't you sit down and think about it for a long time? It's just, for some reason, never happens. When he meets Moses, he tells him, here's what you should do, and then he tells him, get out and do it. When he goes to Isaiah, he says, I know you're young, but get out and do it. And never hears a message and sit. And that's what I want to encourage you, is you're going to hear a lot of stuff today, just like you heard now. Don't keep it to yourself. Don't be selfish. Try to speak it up. Find places where you can spread this message that, you know, Christians and Muslims getting along, but also that the best way for peace to Israelis, to Palestinians, is it through end of the occupation. It is not an anti-Israel thing. It's not an anti-Jewish. It is pro-justice for everyone. And that's the message I want to leave you with. Thank you.
And thank you to both of you.